بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. All praises due to Allah, we praise Him, we seek His help and we seek His forgiveness. We seek refuge in Allah from the evil of ourselves and from the consequences of our bad deeds. Whomever Allah guides, there is no one that can lead him astray, and whoever Allah allows to go astray, there will be no one to guide him. I bear witness that there is nothing worthy of worship and obedience except Allah. He's alone without any partners, and I reject all false gods and ideologies and religions. And I bear witness that Muhammad is his servant and his messenger. O you who believe, fear Allah as he should be feared, do what he commands and stay away from what he forbids, put a separation between yourselves and Allah's punishment, and do not die except in a state of submission as Muslims. O mankind, fear your Lord, who created you from a single soul, and from it created its mate, and from them both spread many men and women. And fear your Lord, from whom you demand your mutual rights, and do not cut off your family ties. Indeed, Allah is ever watchful over you. O you who believe, fear Allah. Have taqwa of Allah. Do what Allah commands and stay away from what He forbids. And say that which is correct. If you do so, Allah will rectify your deeds and forgive you of your sins. And whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has attained the highest success. As to what follows, the best narrative is the speech of Allah in the Quran, and the best guidance is the example of our blessed Messenger sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam. The worst of affairs are issues that people introduce into this religion of Islam. Every introduced issue is an innovation, and every innovation leads astray. Everything that leads astray leads into the hellfire. I welcome you, brothers and sisters, to your family Friday night. And I am very grateful that I was invited to this beautiful masjid and this beautiful community that I hold dearly to my heart. I ask Allah to make you all from those that Allah has blessed, and those that Allah has guided, and those that Allah is pleased with. Today's topic, as you might have heard, is seeking divine guidance. Us as Muslims, as we all know, we must pray 5 times a day, perform the ritual called Salah, a prescribed prayer. In that prayer, in every single rak'ah, according to a group of the scholars, it is a pillar to recite Surah Al-Fatiha, the opening surah of the Quran. If you do the math, that would equal to 17 times per day, at least, that you recite this surah. There is a verse in this surah where Allah Azza wa Jal says, and it should be the prayer of the believers, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ. After praising Allah in the opening of the chapter and describing Him with some of His beautiful attributes, then He says, إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدُ وَإِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. We worship You alone, O Allah, and we seek help from You alone, O Allah. Then He says, اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمَ. Guide us to the straight path. And of course, the description, صِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ, the path of those that you are pleased with and those that have gained your favor. غَيْرِ الْمَغْضُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ, not the path of those that you're angry with or those who have deserved your anger. وَلَا الضَّالِّينَ, not the path of those that are led astray and misguided. The scholars differed as to what does صراط المستقيم mean. Some said it means Islam, the religion of Islam. Some said it means the Sunnah. Some said it means Abu Bakr and Umar and the companions. Some said it means the jama'ah and so forth. There is many interpretations for Sirat al-Mustaqim in this context, but they're all supportive of each other. There is no contradiction. When you say Sirat al-Mustaqim is Islam or Sunnah, well, there is only one Islam, which is the way of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. When you say Sirat al-Mustaqim is the Sahaba or Abu Bakr and Umar, because those were the ones that the Prophet died and he was pleased with. And whatever they carried was the correct religion and the straight path. This is not my topic, but I just wanted us to reflect. The topic is seeking divine guidance. In my community in North Hollywood, I think some brothers were there yesterday, so they cheated. They kind of got a preview of today's talk. As we all know, the consultation business is a multi-million dollar business all over Earth. You consult. There is consultants in all types of things. You have financial consultants, tax consultants, political consultants, you have think tanks. Basically, people that give advice. People that others feel the need to go to and seek their advice. And this is all fine because Allah Azza wa Jalla says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask the people who are aware, those who have knowledge, those who are experts in whatever field, if you don't know. So if you don't know something about a particular field, then go to the experts in that field. Seeking divine guidance is speaking about how many of us consult with the divine, how many of us consult with Allah Most High. We already said that mostly everybody consults. Now some people don't consult, unfortunately. They're like, they just make up their minds and they do whatever they want to do. But a lot of others, they do consult. But we're speaking about the right type of consultation. The Prophet ﷺ did something very beautiful. He taught his companions. As the narration says, he taught them a particular dua, a particular supplication, a particular prayer, as he would teach them a chapter of the Quran, a surah of the Quran. Now, if you understand what this means, you know, we just said the importance of Fatiha. It is the thing that establishes your salah. We all understand what the importance of the Quran is. It's the speech of Allah. It's the message that Allah sent for us to live our lives by. The Prophet ﷺ would teach this particular dua as he taught a surah of the Quran. Now, have we ever heard this before? Maybe if you've studied the fiqh of salah, Ibn Mas'ud, may Allah be pleased with him, he says that the Prophet ﷺ taught us tashahud, where you say at-tahiyyatu lillahi, with the different narrations. He says he taught us at-tashahud as he would teach us a surah of the Quran. Again, establishing the importance of this particular statement. Today's narration is narrated in many books of hadith. It's an authentic report narrated by Bukhari, Abi Dawood, Tirmidhi, Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, and others. So basically, you're talking about 5 out of 6 of the major books of hadith. It's an authentic report on the authority of Jabir ibn Abdullah, may Allah be pleased with him and his father. He says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to teach us a prayer to seek Allah's assistance and guidance in a decision. In the same way that he taught them a chapter of the Quran. And he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, إِذَا هَمَّ أَحَدُكُمْ بِالْأَمْرِ فَلْيَرْكَعْ رَكْعَتَيْنِ مِنْ غَيْرِ الْفَرِيضَةِ. If one of you is concerned with an issue, if an issue crosses someone's mind, if an idea pops up, then let him pray 2 rak'at that are not an obligatory salah. ثُمَّ لِيَقُلْ. Then let him say the following prayer. And the prayer is, اللهم إني أستخيرك بعلمك وأستقدرك بقدرتك وأسألك من فضلك العظيم فإنك تقدر ولا أقدر وتعلم ولا أعلم وأنت علام الغيوب. اللهم إن كنت تعلم أن هذا الأمر ويسمي حاجته خير لي في ديني ومعاشي وعاقبة أمري وفي رواية وفي عاجل أمري وآجله فاقدره لي ويسره لي ثم بارك لي فيه. وإن كنت تعلم أن هذا الأمر شر لي في ديني ومعاشي وعاقبة أمري فاصرفه عني واصرفني عنه واقدر لي الخير حيث كان ثم أرضني به. I purposely read the whole prayer in Arabic, in the Arabic language, as the Prophet ﷺ taught his companions, because we just said he taught them this prayer as he would teach them a chapter of the Quran. And we all know that the Quran is only Quran, which is in the Arabic language. Now we're going to delve into the meanings and the lessons that we get out of this particular dua, inshaAllah ta'ala. This is why we have gathered here tonight, and we are speaking about seeking divine guidance. So you are asking Allah for advice. Does Allah speak to people? Our religion is not the religion that says, God spoke to me. I was in the closet and the Lord spoke to me. Or the Holy Ghost or anything of that sort. This is not our religion. Allah has spoken. There is no doubt, and His speech is the Quran. And it's the best of speech as we started this lecture. And Allah Azza wa Jal has given us a manual to live our lives by. And that's the source of guidance, which is the Quran. Here, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is saying, if one of you thinks to do something, he should pray two units of prayer, two raka'at. Aside from the obligatory prayer, then he should say, O Allah, and let's hear the meanings now. O Allah, I seek your decision, or I seek your guidance, or I seek your assistance, or I seek your blessing in the choice that I make. And we're going to stop here with the word istikhara, because that's the first word. Allahumma inni astakhiruka. A small bit of Arabic. When a verb in Arabic has a hamza and a sin coming before it, and we hear this a lot. There is a lot of different terms that we hear, such as istighfar. What does that mean? To seek maghfirah from Allah. Isti'adha. To seek protection and refuge in Allah. When you say, A'udhu billahi minash shaitan ar-rajim. Isti'ana. When we say, Nahmaduhu wa nasta'inu. We are seeking His help and assistance. And this is istikhara. So when you say is before a verb, you're talking about seeking something and asking for it. Istakhara has another verb in it, which is out of khair, the root of it, and it means the better of two things, or the good of two things. So you're asking Allah Azza wa Jal to guide you, you're seeking Him to help you choose that which is better for you. In the specific context of this hadith, it means that a person is asking Allah for the best of two possibilities. For example, I either do this or don't do it. And that's what we'll learn in the hadith. The Prophet ﷺ, when he says, when one of you thinks about doing something, we want to underline that and say that the Prophet ﷺ did not intend that whenever you think about something, because we think about a whole variety of things. It's specific to things that are lawful in Islam. For example, somebody says, well, I thought about drinking intoxicants. Let me pray istikhara and ask Allah for guidance. Should I do this or should I leave it? Or, and subhanAllah, it's amazing, and I mentioned this as an example, and somebody came right afterwards and asked me this specifically. A brother says, I want to marry a non-Muslim woman, and I'm attracted to her. Should I pray istikhara on this? Inshallah, we'll learn in tomorrow's class what the ruling of marriage to non-Muslims is. But basically, there are conditions. If she's a believer in Islam, or she's Jewish or Christian, and she's modest, and she protects her honor and her dignity, and she doesn't sleep around, then it's lawful according to some of the scholars. Some of the scholars shut that door off and they say she has to be a believer and fulfill the other conditions. So anyway, somebody's saying, I want to go out on a date. Let's be more frank. Not I want to marry. Let's pray istikhara on a date. Let's pray istikhara on a sister giving her number out to somebody to give her a call. She's attracted to him. She wants to give him da'wah. and she wants to pray istikhara. Should I do this or should I not do that? Or the sister might be in love with a disbeliever, and that's clear cut. A woman who's a Muslim is not allowed to marry a disbeliever, no matter what his belief is. So this woman now, she's attracted to this disbeliever, and she's praying istikhara, oh Allah, make it happen for me. It's not happening. So you must ask for things that are lawful. Let's think again outside the box. Somebody wants to pray istikhara about praying Fajr on time. Oh Allah, should I pray Fajr at 5 o'clock or pray it at noon? You don't pray istikhara, you don't seek divine advice and divine guidance for things that are obligatory. It's there and it's mandatory and you must do it the way the law says. You seek istikhara for decisions in life that are lawful, that are in the mubah zone. We have a haram zone and a halal zone. You don't deal with those zones. And under the mubah, of course, under the haram and the halal, there is the mustahab, and there is, or under the haram and the wajib, there is the mustahab and there is the makruh. Those also follow along. But now we're talking about the middle here, which is mubah. Things that are lawful, there is no particular ruling about these issues. This is what you ask Allah for guidance on. Given examples. You have an opportunity to buy a house in an Islamic way. You pray istikhara. Like a brother today came to me, we were in the Inland Empire, and he says, look brother, I just got accepted to Cal State Pomona, and I want to rent an apartment in this neighborhood. Is this a good neighborhood? So now he's consulting. So now he's got this option. I want to move into this neighborhood. I want to move in right next door to this masjid. This is where, because you're making a decision prior to this decision being made, as soon as the idea comes into your mind, you go and you pray these two rak'at and you ask Allah for His guidance. To facilitate for you this affair, either to make it easy for you, as we will learn in the translation of the meanings of the prayer. This means that the time for istikhara is when a person's heart first inclines to doing something. As soon as the heart inclines, and the Prophet ﷺ says, إِذَا هَمَّ. Hem is one of the categories of ideas. You know, ideas come across your mind, but some of them go. Like, they say that in a minute, you have thousands of ideas coming on your mind. Now, some people give you advice of recording your ideas, because they can be genius ideas. Many people don't record their ideas, and they get lost. Now, there is a stage after the idea crosses the mind, where it kind of becomes kind of firm. And it becomes somewhat of a concern. Somebody's actually interested in it. And this is the stage of being hem. Because now you're actually interested. You want to do something. You're desiring something. That type of person should seek Allah's blessing by praying to Him, asking Him for what is best. He's not a person who's fully decided. We're not talking about, okay, I went inside the contract for this house. Or another example that's clear cut, marriage. And the brothers who are studying in fiqh of love, they covered this last week with istikhara. In marriage, for example, you propose to someone, a brother or a sister gets someone who proposes to her. Now, you pray istikhara prior to making your mind up. But you're like, look, that's the person. We're signing the contract, but let me pray istikhara. That's not really asking for divine guidance. That says, I made up my mind already, and I'm just doing a ritual. In Islam, our acts of worship have meanings behind them. They're not empty, they have a soul. So you're actually proven your servitude to Allah Azza wa Jalla, and the fact that you're a servant, you're a abd, or a sister, you're an amma, a servant of Allah Azza wa Jalla, and you're in need of His guidance. I have not made up my mind yet. I'm asking you, O Allah, to make it clear for me and to bless me in the choice that I make. Then you can make your decision. But do things in priorities. Go to Allah first. Take it to Allah. This word hem, again, it means to have an initial resolve to want to do something without actually doing it again. It's not firm. A person should seek Allah's guidance with an open mind. Now we should seek Allah's decision in all of our affairs. And I heard of certain people that do not do anything in life prior to asking Allah for guidance. The sister that I heard about does not leave the house prior to praying istikhara. Doesn't go out to the market, even out of necessity. Now, mashallah, she has the Quran memorized and she's a teacher of the Quran and so forth. But that just proves to us that some people have a closer relationship with Allah Azza wa Jal, where they feel that they're constantly in need of Allah Azza wa Jal, and those are the true servants of Allah. Whenever we feel a sense of independence and that I can do it on my own, you know, I'm powerful, I got strength and I got energy and I got the brains, and then we forget about Allah Azza wa Jal. Even though we say we're Muslim and you know Islam means to surrender to Allah, to obey Allah, to worship Allah, but in reality, how it translates into our actions, it's a different story altogether. So the closer you are to Allah, the more you seek of His guidance. We just gave an example of Surah Al-Fatiha. The basic Muslim, the one who's only inside of Islam, like he hasn't left Islam, he prays 5 times a day. And he's asking Allah for spiritual guidance 17 times every day. Does that mean he's misguided? No, he's asking Allah to guide him and to keep him firm on guidance. And to protect him from being misguided constantly. We should not consider any matter as too small. Oh man, this is so insignificant. Why should I ask Allah for guidance? And how many times does something that's very insignificant get us in deep trouble? As simple as seeing somebody on the bus and smiling to them. They happen to be the opposite gender. And that's one of the gates of the shaitan. That's how he starts. Khutwat shaitan, the steps of shaitan. And it might lead to disasters afterwards. Don't think that anything is insignificant. Okay, you know, I want to go to a university. I applied to basically the UC system or the Cal State system. Which one should I go to? That's a decision in life. I have a brother, I met a brother, or what have you. He might not be a Muslim. I'm going to do a business transaction. That's a decision in life. Don't think that it's too light. Take advantage of that opportunity. Take it to Allah and ask Him for guidance. That's the message. The message is remembering who you are and remembering who Allah is. And we're going to understand this through the meanings of the dua. Many affairs that we take lightly, like we said, can bring great harm to us. And the Prophet ﷺ actually said this, and this is one of the etiquettes, that you do not ask any human being for anything of your needs. Even if it was something very insignificant. They described the Sahaba and how much trust they had in Allah Azza wa Jal, that, you know, at that time, the mode of transportation was not American or Japanese cars, it was the camel. When you ride on a camel or any animal, you have something like a stick where you try to move it around and, you know, have the animal move. Prophet ﷺ says, if that whip falls out of your hand, don't ask anybody for it. Ask Allah. And go down and get it yourself. So again, that's the focus. That's how these people were. And their description is, they would never ask the human beings even for something so insignificant. Oh, my pen fell on the floor. Brother, can you please hook it up because I'm the imam and I'm special. So, no, I should get it for myself, asking Allah. Again, we said, the scholars say that this salat of istikhara does not include things that we already know, that are clear cut, that are black and white, haram and halal. It doesn't include that. Or wajib, sorry, wajib and haram. Forbidden or obligatory. Because the answer to these things is already known. Like, what are you going to say? Oh Allah, guide me to realize whether salah is obligatory 5 times a day? Doesn't make sense. Those things are already clear cut. Now, let's go back, inshallah, and translate some of the meanings, because the meanings are amazing in this. You are going to Allah Azza wa Jal and you're saying, Allahumma. Asking Allah by one of His names. Oh Allah. إِنِّي أَسْتَخِيرُكَ بِعِلْمِكَ I am asking you for the better decision. I am asking you to guide me, like we said, in making a choice due to your abundant knowledge. Because Allah knows everything. He is the most knowledgeable. وَأَسْتَقْدِرُكَ بِقُدْرَتِكَ I'm asking you the ability to grant me the ability, the strength, through your strength, because لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله. There's no power, no strength, no might, except that which is given to us by Allah. Except through the help of Allah. وَأَسْأَلُكَ مِنْ فَضْلِكَ الْعَظِيمِ And I'm asking you by your tremendous and great bounty and grace. فَإِنَّكَ تَقْدِرُ وَلَا أَقْدِرُ Oh Allah, you're able and I am unable. Showing complete weakness. And that's how the servant is. And this is what the prayer is teaching us. Oh Allah, you are able and I am not able. وَتَعْلَمُ وَلَا أَعْلَمُ You know and I do not know.
Again, these are attributes of Allah. And this is for us humbling ourselves toward our Lord. Oh Allah, you're able and I'm not. Even though I'm muscle man, I'm not able. Even though I know it all, I don't know it all. There is no such thing. And if you think so, you need to check yourself. You don't know it all. Allah knows it all. وَأَنْتَ عَلَّامُ الْغُيُوبِ Again, describing Allah. And you are the one who knows everything. You know the unseen. This now goes in line with the rest of the etiquettes of dua. This is a particular dua that the Prophet ﷺ said. But when you study about the etiquettes of dua, they say you should start off dua by praising Allah Azza wa Jal. Glorifying Allah Azza wa Jal. Describing Allah Azza wa Jal by His beautiful names and attributes. Because Allah Azza wa Jal loves to be praised. And He is praiseworthy. So you're asking Him, Oh Allah, You're the most merciful. Ya Rahman, Ya Rahim. When you say Alhamdulillah, look at Surah Al-Fatiha. Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, all praises due to Allah, the Lord of everything. Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. Again, most merciful, most gracious. Maliki Yawm al-Din, you own. You're the king of the day of judgment, the day of resurrection, the day of payback. Then you ask, after praising. Now, this makes sense, even if you were to ask a human being. Don't ask humans. But if you want to go to your dad and you're a child and you're like, Daddy, I love you. You're so good. You work so hard. Can I get $10? Same thing. Mommy, you cooked so good today. The meal was wonderful. You should make, you know, whatever. Can I go out? The same story. So even with human beings. Now Allah Azza wa Jal is far above that. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى He loves to be praised. The more you do of it, like, you can't do enough of praise. You can't do enough of it. After he mentions all these things that are related to praising Allah. Oh Allah, I'm asking you to guide me through your knowledge. And I'm asking you to give me the ability through your power and strength. Because you know everything and I don't know. You're able and I am not. After all of that, you say, Allahumma in kunta ta'lamu anna hadha al-amra. Oh Allah, if it's in your knowledge that this particular thing, let's say, a business transaction. We have a lot of businessmen. Oh Allah, if you know that me becoming a partner with Abdullah, khayrun li, is good for me. And look at the sequence, the order. Fi dini. The most important thing is mentioned first. In my spiritual life, in my religious affairs, in my way of life, of Islam. If this is something good for me, if me being partners with Abdullah is positive for me, in my religion, وَمَعَاشِي, and my livelihood. Look at how you're asking. You're asking about your deen first. Is it good for me in my deen? Because it might be good for me in my livelihood. Like this brother, I'm partnering up with him and he's a millionaire. It's like winning the lottery guaranteed, so it's very good for my livelihood. But maybe for my deen it's not. Why? Because the guy is a millionaire through riba. His money is suht. It's nasty money, filthy money that you need to get rid of. So he might be good for you in your ma'ash, your livelihood, but he's not good for you in your deen. Because he's going to take you straight to the hellfire. You're going to be waging war with Allah. That's not a winning battle. I'm sorry, I'm going to tell you the result right now. Allah will crush you. May Allah protect us from that. So, fi dini wa ma'ashi, then he says, wa aqibati amri. And then my long term, because something might be positive right now in the short term. It's good for my religion right now, and it's good for my livelihood right now, but how about the final destination? How about 10 years down the line? How about when I end my life? Is this going to be something good for me or not? Or am I going to look back and say, I regret that decision? Again, something that a lot of people want to do is marriage. This spouse, they might be religious. So it's good in deen. Again, I'm going to give the opposite example. But it's not good for my ma'ash because the brother is broke. And he doesn't have a job. And he does not want to work. And he's abusive. He's not good for your livelihood. He's righteous, he's always in the masjid, but he's not a husband. He's a religious man. So he might be good religiously for you. But again, be wise. Look at the dua saying, in my religion and in my livelihood. And then in my final destination, وَعَاقِبَةِ أَمْرِي. And then there is another narration that says, وَعَاجِلِ أَمْرِي وَعَاجِلِ. In the short term and in the long term, both. فَقْدِرْهُ لِي Then make it happen for me. If you know, oh Allah, that this is something good for me, spiritually, materially, my long term and short term future, then make it happen for me. وَيَسِّرْهُ لِي And facilitate the means for it. Make it easy. And after you do that, after you make it happen, and you make it easy, ثُمَّ بَارِكْ لِي فِيهِ Make it full of blessings. Full of barakah from you, O Allah. That's the first phase. This is if something is positive. But then you're going to ask for the other choice, because everything is either good or bad. وَإِن كُنْتَ تَعْلَمْ O Allah, if you know, أَنَّ هَذَا الْأَمْرَ شَرٌ لِي That this affair, this particular issue, and you're supposed to mention it again. Marrying Sarah. Is it, if it's bad for me, again, شَرٌ لِي فِي دِينِي In my religion, my spiritual life. وَمَعَاشِي My livelihood, my regular life. وَعَقِبَةِ أَمْرِي My future. فَصْرِفْهُ عَنِّي Keep it away from me. وَصْرِفْنِي عَنْهُ Keep me away from it. Like, basically, this means I'm going east and that thing is going west. And we're just going to get further and further. There's no coming back. That's what you're asking Allah. Keep it as far away from me as possible. Then he says, وَقْدِرْ لِيَ الْخَيْرِ And decree for me that which is good. حَيْثُ كَانْ Wherever it might be. Because maybe that which is good is something that's not in my mind. عَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ Maybe you hate something and it's good for you. I'm not even considering Sister Fatima. But she's the right person. وَقْدِرْ لِيَ الْخَيْرَ حَيْثُ كَانْ ثُمَّ أَرْضِنِي بِهِ After you grant me that which is good, wherever it might be, make me pleased with it. Make me satisfied. Because sometimes, you have something and it's great for you, but you're not satisfied yet. You don't recognize that this job is good for you. And the shaitan comes to you, they ain't paying you enough, they're not giving you your rights. You might have a beautiful life as a family. The shaitan comes to you and he says, the man is not good enough, he doesn't take us on trips, he doesn't take us to this place and that place, he doesn't buy me gold, or the sister. The sister's dying hard, working at home and taking care of the kids, and the brother's like, she doesn't look like so-and-so. She doesn't do this, and she doesn't do that. They forget about all the blessings that Allah gave them, and they look at something that they don't have. This is a sign of somebody not having rida with Allah Azza wa Jal, not being pleased with the blessings that Allah has given them. So again, the dua is teaching us, Oh Allah, decree for me that which you're pleased with, that which is good, and make me pleased with it. Grant me that satisfaction. Salatul istikhara is 2 rak'at. The Prophet ﷺ says, from the non-obligatory salawat, which includes everything other than the 5 daily salawat. Now there is a difference of opinion amongst the scholars. For example, you walk into the masjid. There is a prayer called the greeting of the masjid, tahiyyatul masjid. It's 2 rak'at. Can you do istikhara after these 2 rak'at? Difference of opinion amongst the scholars. The best and the safest is to just make it 2 rak'at out of nowhere, like voluntary, complete voluntary. Like don't try to combine intentions in this. Because you're trying, you're asking Allah for guidance. Make it special. This doesn't mean that it's not allowed. Like we said, some scholars say it is allowed as long as prior to you praying Tahiyyatul Masjid, you had the intention for 2 things. You're like, this is Tahiyyatul Masjid and this is Istikhara. But some people are lazy. They're like, I prayed Tahiyyatul Masjid. And then after he prayed Tahiyyatul Masjid, he's like, oh, I remembered that sister, you know, I proposed to her. Let me pray Istikhara now. Let me make the dua. That's the issue that causes problems. So 2 rak'at, you recite Surah Al-Fatiha and anything afterwards. You make this dua. Difference of opinion amongst the scholars, when do you make the dua? Do you make it during the salah, prior to salam? Or do you make it after the salam? Again, safest opinion, due to the ordering of the hadith, the Prophet ﷺ says, let him pray 2 rak'at, then let him make the prayer. So he's actually finished and concluded the salah, and he makes salams. And then he makes this dua, and he makes this prayer. So these are fiqh issues, and we don't want to get into, you know, too much detail about fiqh, but we want to learn the spiritual aspects of this. And that's why we called it seeking divine guidance. We want to learn something from this, and we want to try to apply it. Make this one of our not habits, but something in our lives that we're constantly with. And we should all try this. I want to go to the masjid for Salat al-Isha, but I got two options. I got this masjid and I got another neighboring masjid. Pray istikhara like that. Start with something slow. Train yourself to seek Allah's guidance for everything in life. And then when the big decisions come, you're already prepared. It's become something, a part of you. Like, I can't make the decision yet. Let me take it to Allah. Let me go to Allah. Because He knows and I don't know. He's able and I'm not. And let Him bless my choice. After you pray istikhara, of course there's a lot of misconceptions that istikhara, for example, is something that you must see a dream after. Or you must see a sign after. And this is not to be found in Islam. And there is nothing about praying istikhara and falling asleep right afterwards. That's not from the teachings of the Prophet ﷺ. That might be a tradition of the people, but it's foreign to the teachings of the Prophet ﷺ, in the sense of, he didn't say anything after that. He just said, do that, because you're asking Allah to guide you. And then you make a decision. فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Whenever you have a firm resolve in doing something, seek Allah's bounty, trust in Allah, rely on Allah, and go ahead and do it. Now the thing might fail, and it might be successful. That's beside the point. Your original istikhara was about the decision. Should I go right or not? Now after you go right, you can have an accident. This does not mean that the istikhara failed. That's beside the point. Your istikhara was about the decision. Oh Allah, guide me and bless my choice. The choice that I'm making. There is an issue that we mentioned early on, that the consultation business is very profitable. Should you consult with people prior to istikhara, or should you consult with people after istikhara? That's another fiqhi debate. You can do it either way. It's good to consult, without a doubt, especially those who are experts, and those who fear Allah, and those who care about you. You don't go to your enemy and tell him, what do you think? There is a sister, and she is extremely beautiful, extremely religious, comes from a good background, she's got the whole package, like the package of four. What do you think? But he's your enemy. He's like, no man, I advise you to stay away from it, brother. Because I'm not feeling right. He's your enemy, how is he going to feel right about it? Or you go consulting a disbeliever who has not given Allah his rights. He's rebellious against his Lord. He is blinded. He can't see his own direction. You expect him to be your GPS? Doesn't work. The GPS lady is not a human being. So that's why you follow her instructions. She's a computer. Again, should you consult? Yes, you should consult with people. And the scholars say, this is not a hadith, but they say the one who seeks people's advice, and this is what istishara is. I am asking you for your shura. Again, with hamza seen, istishara. So they say, the one who does so, who seeks for consultation, is not disappointed. And the one who seeks divine guidance, man istakhar la yandam. He does not regret. Ma nadima man istakhar walau man istashar. How does the order go? The people who know Arabic already. All the Arabs forgot it. Good. Let's keep it in English then. Okay, basically it's ما ندم من استشار وما خاب من استخار. So whoever consults will not be disappointed, and whoever seeks divine guidance will never regret it, because you've taken it to Allah Azza wa Jal. So there should be no regret afterwards. Like we said, you say it after you conclude your salah. What are some of the benefits? Some of the benefits of this particular hadith is reminding the believers of how important it is to seek Allah's help, to seek Allah's guidance. Because sometimes we get so caught up in this life that we forget the real important things. And the real important thing in this life, it should be the axis of your whole life. It should be what your life revolves around. It's the purpose of your life. And the purpose of your life is to serve Allah Azza wa Jal, and to obey Him and to establish His commandments in your life. So when you do something like that, that constantly reminds you. When you remember Allah, when you do dhikr, you're constantly reminded of Allah Azza wa Jal. So it shows us the importance of seeking help from Allah in our decisions. and how strongly the Prophet ﷺ encouraged us to do so. Now, there might be a misunderstanding or a misconception. This means istikhara is an obligation. Before every decision, I must pray istikhara. That's not an understanding of the scholars of Islam. It is encouraged. It's highly encouraged. But the obligations as far as salah is concerned are five. Those are basically the bare minimum. But they are the ones that you must perform. Everything else is encouraged. So keep that in the back of your mind. So if someone prays, makes a decision and he didn't do istikhara, don't go and say, brother, you're sinful, you didn't ask Allah for guidance. He's not sinful for that. He might be sinful for forgetting about Allah, but he's not sinful for leaving istikhara because it's not an obligation. So there's no sin, inshallah, about that. But a person, like I said, should try to make this his custom. This prayer, this dua, it means submitting our affairs to Allah Azza wa Jal and asking Him to secure for us what is good in this world and in the next. It implies an admission of our powerlessness. We have no power. And our complete dependence on Allah Azza wa Jal. There's no better way to humble yourself than to make such a prayer. Because it reminds you, if you truly believe in it. And by the way, we shouldn't make any statement if we don't believe in it. For example, you see a Muslim and you're like, Assalamu alaikum, and then you're backbiting him and you're cursing him. And you have just rejected your statement. When you said Assalamu alaikum, that means no evil or harm is ever going to come to you from me. Nothing. That's why you can't give that greeting to a non-Muslim. Because there might be harm and evil. I mean, but with a Muslim, even if he wrongs you, you don't hurt the Muslim. That's why you tell him, Assalamu alaikum. So don't contradict your statements with the actions. Likewise, this dua, first of all, we must memorize it, like the Prophet ﷺ taught his companions, as if it was a surah in the Quran, and we should constantly practice it. But we should not contradict the statements that are being made through our actions. So if I'm saying, oh Allah, you know and I don't know, I shouldn't think that I know it all in certain things and then go to Allah with certain things. For example, you know, simple things, decisions that are very simple, I do istikhara. But big time decisions, no need. I'm the expert in this. You know, and I just do it on my own. So let's not contradict our statements through our actions. Remember that istikhara itself, you're not asking Allah to make the decision for you. You are making your own decision. You're asking Allah to bless the decision that you make. Allah does not force anyone to do anything. He knows, because that's part of Him being Allah, because He's different than His creation. His knowledge, wasi'a kulla shay, it has encompassed everything, which is for us past, future, and present. But for Allah, it's all the same. There is no past, future, and present. So, you're not asking Allah to make a decision for you. You're asking Him to bless your choice. Another misconception that people might have is going to a righteous person, like a saint, to ask him to do the istikhara on your behalf. And I saw this personally. Like, I wouldn't believe this until I saw it in a country in the Middle East. There is a marketplace, a traditional market, like the markets from the times of the Turks, like old style. It's not Turkey, by the way, but because the Turks ruled all that region. And there is one store. You walk into the store, there is a man sitting on a table. And he's got a mushaf in front of him. He's known to be very righteous to the people. What does he do there? He gives charity, like people bring him bread and he gives bread out to the poor. And he also prays istikhara on people's behalf. He's got an istikhara hotline. Sheikh, can you pray istikhara if I should marry Fatima? The Prophet ﷺ says, if one of you is concerned with something, let him do two rak'at. He didn't say, let him take it to somebody else. But that is what has crept into Islam from other religions. Going to priests and monks and religious people, clerics, because supposedly they're purer, so they're closer to God. No, they're not. Maybe somebody who has knowledge about the religion might be worse than a normal person if he doesn't apply his knowledge, because knowledge is the evidence against you. So don't think that that's the case. So you do istikhara on your own behalf. You are not to be asking anyone else to do istikhara on your behalf. Like we said, nothing about sleeping after it. It's not required and it's not recommended and it's got nothing whatsoever to do with the salah. Now your heart afterwards might incline one way or the other. You might feel so comfortable. And then again, the answer of the prayer might be there because you're saying to Allah, facilitate it for me, make it easy for me. And then you see that this particular thing is happening. For example, a brother proposes to a sister. His family loves the girl. Her family loves him. They're not dealing with problems. You know, they don't have drama. They don't have traditions that prevent good from happening. Everything is going smoothly. And the person's like, I prayed istikhara and I didn't get an answer. So I'll just drop his sister. You're not going to get an answer. That was your answer. Allah facilitating everything. Everything is cool. Everything is dandy. That's facilitation. That is an answer of your dua. You said, وَيَسِّرْهُ لِي, make it easy for me. He has made it easy for you. So go ahead and take it. Again, to sum up, this reminds us to humble ourselves. Reminds us of Allah's Azza wa Jal status and His attributes. And it reminds us of He has a status, whether we want to recognize it or not. But it reminds us that we should recognize this for our own benefit. That we should recognize and knock on Allah's door, seeking His advice, seeking divine guidance, asking Him, Oh Allah, bless my choice. Oh Allah, help me out with this situation. Grant me that which is good and keep me away and distant from that which is bad. And mind you, another answer is, for example, you propose to somebody, and that person just disappears off the face of the earth. But you're in love. Guess what? It's not superstition. But he's disappeared. Guess what happened? He went east and he went west. Allah did what you asked for. فَصْرِفْنِي عَنْهُ, keep me away from it. وَصْرِفْهُ عَنِّي, keep it away from me. So that's a sign. And subhanAllah, last night after the class, I had two situations. And it was exactly what I'm talking about. And subhanAllah, the person says, but Allah is able to bring him back to me. I'm like, the person, subhanAllah, this person does not fear Allah, of course. Not the individual asking, but that person has filed a restraining order. What does that mean? That means if you come close, you're going to get jacked up. Stay away from it. Allah has kept you away from it. You should stay away from it. So again, get the hint. Get the hint. No sleeping and having dreams. No going to anybody else. Go to Allah. Knock on His door. وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ وَدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Again, it's a lesson in Tawheed. For us to realize and recognize Allah Azza wa Jal more fully, your Lord has said, call unto me and I will answer you. It's guaranteed. But people, for some reason, I don't know what's wrong with their brains. They want to go the twisted route. No, I'm sinful. I can't go to Allah. Let me go to the Mawlana Sahib. Let me go to the Shaykh and to the Imam and to the priest and to this and that. That's man-made religion. The religion that Allah is pleased with is وَقَالَ رَبُّكُمْ أُدْعُونِي أَسْتَجِبْ لَكُمْ. Your Lord has told all of y'all, if you call unto me, I will answer you. That's the formula. Go back to Allah. Ask Him for His guidance. عز وجل. We ask Allah عز وجل to guide us all. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jal to grant us the ability to implement what we learned today. And of course, many of us know these things, so it's just a reminder, inshallah. And we ask Allah to make us amongst those people who sit down and remember Him in one of His homes. And then, inshallah, tranquility comes down upon us. The angels are surrounding us. The grace and mercy of Allah comes upon us. And Allah mentions us in a better place. So we ask Allah to make us from among those people. SubhanAllah, I had the hadith, and I wanted to start the class with, but I guess I'll end it with this, inshallah. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, in a long hadith, he says, وَمَجْتَمَعَ قَوْمٌ فِي بَيْتٍ مِّن بُيُوتِ اللَّهِ يَتْلُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَيَتَدَارَسُونَهُ بَيْنَهُمْ إِلَّا نَزَلَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّكِينَةِ وَغَشِيَتْهُمُ الرَّحْمَةِ وَحَفَّتْهُمُ الْمَلَائِكَةِ وَذَكَرَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي مَنْ عِنْدَهَا اللَّهُمَّ اجْعَلْنَا مِنْهُمْ. Whenever a group of people come to one of the homes, one of the houses of Allah Azza wa Jal, reciting the book of Allah and studying it with each other. This is what we're doing. We're just studying. I'm not instructing, it's a reminder, and the reminder benefits the believers. Whenever a group of believers, they come together studying the book of Allah, or anything related to the book of Allah, as we said, this the Prophet ﷺ taught as he would teach a surah from the Qur'an. إِلَّا نَزَلَتْ عَلَيْهِمُ السَّكِينَةِ. It's guaranteed. Sakina, tranquility will befall them. وغشيتهم الرحمة, the mercy of Allah عز وجل will be all around them. وحفتهم الملائكة, the angels are surrounding them. And this is a great blessing. وذكرهم الله في من عنده, the greatest of all these blessings that Allah will mention you in a better assembly and in a better gathering. So we ask Allah to make us from amongst those. I guess we'll end inshallah, and I think they said 5 minutes for questions. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على آل إبراهيم وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. Oh Allah, we ask you to raise the rank of our beloved messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم and his righteous followers as you did with the righteous followers in the past, Ibrahim and his companions. And we ask Allah Azza wa Jal, through his glory and his perfection, we have no knowledge other than the knowledge that Allah Azza wa Jal has given us. And we end with رَبَّنَا آتِنَا فِي الدُّنْيَا حَسَنَةً وَفِي الْآخِرَةِ حَسَنَةً وَقِنَا عَذَابَ النَّارِ. Grant us the good of this life and the good of the next life and save us from the hellfire. Wallahu a'lam. InshaAllah, if anyone has questions or concerns, who makes the decision?
Well, I mean, obviously, like, it's you making the decision.
That's it. That's the answer. He has facilitated for you. He has shown you the way to make a decision. But he did not force you to do anything. That's what we have to go back to. That Allah Azza wa Jal is making a way easy for you. You're asking Him to bless this choice. But it is your choice. It's not, you can't say this is Allah's choice. Of course, if it takes place, then it's Allah's decree. It's His qadr. It's His will. وَقَدَرُهُ نَافِذْ جَلَّ وَعَلَى. His will take place no matter what. But He did not force you to do it. And again, that's an aspect of aqeedah and an aspect of qada and qadr. But in this particular salah, what we're trying to get to here is we're asking Him to guide us in this decision-making process. Just like you would when you go to a consultant. If you come to me and you're like, brother, you know, I'm trying to play basketball, but I'm trying to see, am I better at the point guard or the shooting guard? And then I tell you, I see you as a shooting guard. And you're like, okay, I'm going to play the shooting guard. Was it my decision? No. I showed you, I thought there's something good in you that would make you a shooting guard. But also you can always say, he doesn't know, I got balling skills, I'm going to be the point guard. So I didn't force you, I'm just there to help out. Likewise, وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. You're asking him, you're like, direct me, O Allah. And that manifests itself, basically, like we said. What your heart inclines to, if Allah makes something easy or not, if something becomes difficult or not, if somebody, a character, or an affair disappears off the face of the earth, all these things are clear signs, inshallah. Not related to superstition, because we don't have superstition in Islam. I forgot one thing. Can istikhara be prayed more than once? Yes, it can be, but don't make a habit out of it. It's just like any other dua. So, for example, like, if you're asking the impossible, for example, somebody will make dua, oh Allah, is it an obligation for me to do salah 5 times a day? And he can do it forever. That istikhara is not an istikhara, so there's no point behind it. But you'll see, things will manifest themselves for you. So you can make it more than once, inshallah, it doesn't hurt. Because, again, it's you surrendering yourself to Allah Azza wa Jalla and asking Him for guidance.
Is there no provision in high obligatory prayer? You can ask any guidance from Allah. You need to pray separately on the istikhara.
Yes, it must be other than the 5 salawat. That's what he says. مِنْ غَيْرِ الْفَرِيضَةِ. Other than the obligatory salah.
Yes.
So istikhara has to be 2 rak'at, a salah, a separate salah on its own. That has nothing to do with the 5 daily salawat.
But if I don't pray istikhara salah, but I pray 5 times and I ask guidance from Allah, that obligatory?
Well, you're making the dua. Okay, so you're making the dua. The dua is good. But you're not doing it according to the formula the Prophet ﷺ gave you. And of course, the scholars have differed on this issue. Can I make it, for example, in a salah that's 4 rak'at? I want to do nafila, a voluntary prayer, but I don't want to do 2. I want to do 4. So the scholars have differed, but again, we started off this lecture by saying, خَيْرُ الْهَدِي هَدِي مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The best guidance is that of the Messenger ﷺ. He's telling us here, he's giving us instructions. So he's saying, do it from other than the obligatory salawat. So we say, سَمِعْنَا وَأَطَعْنَا. We heard what you had to say, and we obey. We implement. Now you may do that. Again, a sister who might not be doing salah in her period. She wants to pray istikhara. Now the decision is not like a life and death situation. She can delay it for a week, for example, and pray istikhara then. But if she must pray istikhara like right now, then she can just make the dua. She doesn't do salah. And it becomes just like any other dua, and that's similar to what you're saying. But that's not the formula that the Prophet ﷺ gave. In order for this formula to be complete, it must be anafila, a voluntary prayer, 2 raka'at, non-obligatory. Sisters always beat the guys. They never have questions because they know it all. But alhamdulillah, Allah knows better than them. Is that an obligation? For example, Hajj. You're doing istikhara for your Hajj group. You're traveling companions. And it's very important when you take a journey to have good company.
Yeah, but that's like different Hajj group. Are you like deciding, well, should I go Hajj right now?
If you're able to do Hajj, then you should. But there's other things that are related to it. It's not just as simple as doing Hajj. But it's good. The examples you gave are good. Seeking knowledge. Again, that's a voluntary act of worship. It's not an obligation per se to travel overseas to seek knowledge. You're asking Allah for istikhara to make a way for you. That's positive. That's where istikhara is for issues like that. Hajj, after you have the means, but there might be other components missing, like a good group, visa issues, and so forth. Like somebody who doesn't have papers and they're afraid, you know, they're like, should I go out or not? They need a special fatwa for a situation like that. It's not only istikhara anymore. But somebody who's got it all, it's all there, and it's either, should I go this year or not? Especially someone who's done Hajj before. Like it's your second Hajj. Okay, should I do another Hajj, for example? That makes it very clear. It's not an obligation anymore. It's something that's voluntary.
You have two choices, you need to choose one of them. When you have multiple choices, can you do istikhara with that?
Well, again, let's look at what the Prophet ﷺ says. He says, إِذَا هَمَّ أَحَدُكُمْ بِالْأَمْرِ. Something that comes on your mind, you haven't made a decision, you're asking guidance. Should I entertain this or not? So now you're saying, multiple things have come on your mind. Do istikhara for each one. Because it's not as some people think, it's either this sister or that sister, I pray istikhara. No, you're praying istikhara for this sister, and you're praying istikhara for that sister. Because each one is a separate situation. So, the more the better. You're begging Allah, you're praising Allah, you're asking Him for guidance.
Let's say I want to go into the restaurant business and I want to get into a franchise business. So, there's a McDonald's franchise, there's a Carl's Jr. franchise. So, now there are multiple choices. Is the istikhara for going into the business or selecting the franchise?
Both.
So, I can do two things?
Yes. You can do multiple, like we said, because it's different situations now. The first one you want to do, should I go into this type of business? And then, for example, you become convinced that all the meat in this country is not halal. Don't go into that business, because it's no longer an option to pray istikhara for. But you follow another opinion that says, you know, or you can bring sources, halal KFC and so forth. Then it's a different situation. But then, what is easier for you? For example, you got multiple restaurants. Well, one franchisee is going to allow you to sell good meat. And the other is like, no, we want you to sell pork. There's no istikhara there. Because we said it has to be lawful. So if it's something prohibited, then it's kind of like, oh Allah, should I commit fornication or not? This doesn't make sense.
I got a 3-5 offer from job, like, and I don't know which one is better for me.
Do istikhara for each one. Do istikhara for each one. But for example, you're going to eliminate some choices. Like somebody says, man, there's so many sisters in the community. I don't know which one to marry. I'm going to pray 100 istikharas. No, you're really going to eliminate choices. Or the sisters, like 10 people propose to me. Okay, sister, but you know, you ain't going to go with...
I'm talking marry. You are going all the time marry. I'm talking about the offer, job offer.
I'm with you. I'm with you, job offer, but you're going to eliminate it. Like for example, because a lot of the people present here are interested in marriage. Like today I gave the khutbah, a brother came to me afterwards. He's like, brother, can you please encourage the youth to get married? I said, it's not up to me. You know, so I'm mentioning that only as an example. But job offers, I'm sorry. A job offer, you have 3 job offers. Khara for each one. But sometimes you yourself will eliminate choices. So you're making it easier prior to the istikhara. Like a job is like, they're not even going to pay you. Like you are qualified. And they're going to underpay you. Are you going to go for that job? You yourself eliminate it. But sometimes you might still consider it and pray istikhara. And Allah blesses the wealth that you get out of that particular job. So as much as the options, if the options are different, pray istikhara for each option, inshallah. So it's the same as the answer to the other brother. والله أعلم. Can the dua be read from a piece of paper? It can. Of course, the dua is in Arabic. The Prophet ﷺ taught it as a surah in the Quran, as he would teach a surah from the Quran. So it's best to do it in Arabic with realization of the meanings. If you're not able to, even in salah, you can make dua in another language. So according to an opinion of some of the scholars, it's not something that there is a consensus on. So you can say it in other languages, inshallah. That's not an issue. But inshallah, we should try to learn the prayers in Arabic because they are perfect prayers, the ones that the Prophet ﷺ taught us. But we should understand the meaning. Let's not say it with an empty heart. I'm just mentioning it like the Catholics recite Latin. It's a holy language to them, but they don't understand what they're saying. So this is a live language. The Quran is alive. So when you make dua, Allahumma ghafirli, or the Imam is making dua and you're doing ta'meen, understand what he's saying, because the dua sometimes make mistakes. Even in Mecca and Medina, I'm there and the Imam is saying, oh Allah, destroy us, and you got a million people, ameen. Because no one understands what he's saying. So let's understand what we're saying, learn it properly, try to practice it in Arabic. If you're not able to, Allah is merciful and Allah doesn't require you to do something that you're not able to do. You can consider it, but it's not like black and white, that if this happens, then this is what happens. Each situation is different. And the way your heart is inclining. Again, we said it's the heart. Sometimes Allah Azza wa Jalla makes you hate something. We have different job offers, and Allah just makes me hate this company after istikhara or in istikhara. And it's like, okay, there's no reason to pray after that because Allah just made you hate it. That's it. You felt distanced from it. So that might be something. So it's again what you're going through and what manifests itself in front of you, whether Allah facilitates it or not. If you are in a situation where you are not sure whether to stay in it or not, does it matter if you stay in the situation or should you stay away from it? Example, I don't know whether to keep my current job. Do I take vacation or would it not matter? Well, you're in a job, basically, from what I understand. You're confused right now. You don't know, is this something that I should continue doing or should I stop doing this? And mind you, this should be something lawful. This should be something that Allah is pleased with. Again, we're talking about something that's in the mubah zone, the lawful zone. After that, you're in it already. You pray istikhara because there is some type of doubt in your mind. So your istikhara at that time is not going to be whether to continue or not. Your istikhara is, should I leave it? And oh Allah, if you know that leaving it is good for me, then make that happen. And oh Allah, if you know that leaving it is bad for me, then keep it away from me. That's the istikhara. It's about one thing. So here you're already in the job. You're asking guidance whether to leave the job or not. Those are your two options. I hope that's clear. So you're asking Allah, oh Allah, if leaving the job is good for me, make it happen. If leaving the job is bad for me, keep me away from it. And Allah Azza wa Jalla knows best. Allahu A'lam. It's time for salah. Right? SubhanAllah, bihamdik, shahadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu.